Hi, I'm Matt Bird, and these are The Secrets of Story. Today we're going to talk about something that writers frequently forget about, but is super important. It's the importance of having objects in your character's hands. We're going to look at some clips, and look at various ways in which this helps the story and takes the weight off the dialogue. You don't want to have heroes constantly talk about how they really feel, and you really don't want to have them talk about what it all means. That's where objects are so very useful as a writer. You can have their reactions to those objects reveal how they really feel. Let's look at The Squid and the Whale, an Academy Award-winning screenplay. When the screenplay begins, you have a marriage that's in serious trouble, but you don't have them constantly talking about how the marriage is in serious trouble, because that's not how things really work. You don't want to have a million scenes of sitting down and saying, "Honey, what's wrong? We should really talk about it." Instead, they're pretending that everything's okay, but we know that it's not, because they have objects in their hands. As they're trying to be a normal family, they're playing tennis, and they're playing tennis far too aggressively. Another thing that's valuable about having objects is it makes scenes concrete. It's great if every scene ends with an actual object changing hands. This scene has had a concrete effect on the story. Something has happened. Something has changed. You can't just have characters influencing each other. That influence should be signified by the exchange of an object. When one character is hitting on another character, in real life they may just say, "Oh, call me sometime," or they may exchange numbers, but it's always good in a story to have them actually exchange something, such as exchange a card. Now an object has exchanged hands, and this object can keep growing in importance as the story goes forward. It represents this relationship, it represents this encounter, and we can see the character wrestle with this object as they wrestle with the idea of this relationship. They can throw it out, they can get upset with it, they can treasure it. How they relate to this object shows us how they really feel. Let's look at a scene from Groundhog Day. Phil is trying to convince Rita that he's been repeating the same day over and over again, and he now has as much knowledge of his world as he would if he were a god. She is having a hard time believing this, and he talks and talks, and tells her that he knows absolutely everything around them, and Rita is now somewhat convinced that Phil's amazing story must be true, but she still really can't believe it. Then the cameraman comes in to pick them up, and Phil realizes he must write down what the cameraman is about to say, put it on a piece of paper, slide it over to her, and then only when the cameraman says it does she then turn it over and see that it's what Phil has written down, and now she believes him.
You guys ready? We better get going if we're gonna stay ahead of the weather. What's that?
If we're gonna stay ahead of the weather.
It's only the exchange of an object that cuts through all this talk and finally convinces her that what he's saying is true. She has the evidence in her hands. It's there. It's incontrovertible. It's a solid object. It's not just talk anymore. Another way you can use objects is to have totem objects. You can give each character a special object that they always have in their hands that symbolizes the meaning of that character or the character's role in the story. Let's look at the classic film noir Tension. Each character has an object they tend to interact with. The main character, the henpecked husband, has a pair of glasses, and he feels these glasses define him, and he's tired of that definition. They've just invented contact lenses, and he decides to get some and become a new man, but of course, once he loses the glasses that defined him, he feels that he loses all definition, and he finds himself about to commit a crime that he never would have considered before. His unfaithful wife is represented by a doll that she owns, which symbolizes her infantile state. The woman that he should be with twists these little twist ties into little male characters, symbolizing her ability to restore the hero's manhood to him. The police detective carries around a little rubber band in his hand, which he's constantly stretching and stretching, giving the movie its title, Tension, and showing his method of twisting characters until they finally break. The wife's lover has his own totem object, an actual pitchfork. Now this is, you might say, ridiculous. You can't have the bad guy carrying around a pitchfork. Well, you can. People are very forgiving of the melodramatic use of objects. In fact, the audience would much rather have you use objects in a melodramatic way than have you use dialogue in a melodramatic way. Another great thing about objects is that you can reveal the theme through objects in a way that it would be way too painful to have the characters actually discuss it. For instance, let's look at the movie Iron Man. Let's look at the way the heart device is exchanged, and the way in which this carries the thematic meaning of the movie so that no one has to talk about it. In Iron Man, the object that keeps getting passed back and forth is this little heart device that Tony Stark makes for himself. Now, if you'll recall, he's in Afghanistan, he's a cocky billionaire arms dealer playboy, he's traveling with a US Army convoy, the convoy gets attacked, it gets blown up by an Afghan warlord, he sees one of his own bombs with his own name written on it that lands right next to him. It explodes, shrapnel goes right through his bulletproof vest. When he wakes up, he finds that the shrapnel is lodged in his heart, and the only way he can keep it out is he has to build this little device. The device fills a hole in his chest and works as a magnet that keeps the shrapnel from going all the way into his heart. The person who's helped him build this device is another prisoner of the Afghan warlord, who becomes friends with Tony, but he explains to Tony that he knows exactly how these bombs work, because he's seen these bombs kill children in his own village.
I've seen many wounds like that in my village. We call them the Walking Dead.
So Tony is being literally stabbed in the heart by the shrapnel, but he's also being figuratively stabbed in the heart because he's discovered that the slow death that he's experiencing is the same sort of slow death that he's consigned children to all over the world. But he's able to build a new heart with the help of his new friend that will keep him from being stabbed in the heart both literally and figuratively. Now, of course, Tony is able to use this device to help power some iron armor. He rescues himself. He gets home. As soon as he gets home, he says, "You know, that heart device I made for myself in the third world, who needs that? I can make a better, sleeker, first world heart device." And so he invents himself a new device, and then he says, "Oh wait, I have to switch these out. I don't really trust doctors. I'll call in my executive assistant, Pepper, who is, of course, secretly in love with me, but I ignore her and sleep around with everybody else. I'm going to call her in, and I'm going to have her help me remove the old heart device, the one I think I no longer need, and put in this sleek new heart device that I've invented." She then says, "What do I do with the old heart device?" And Tony says,
"Destroy it. Incinerate it."
"You don't want to keep it?"
"Pepper, I've been called many things. Nostalgic is not one of them."
Which, of course, also means I'm not going to fall in love with you. But she says, "I'm going to keep this heart that you gave me. I'm going to keep your old heart," and lets him go off with the new one. Now, of course, after a while, it turns out that the person Tony trusts most in the world, his business partner Stane, actually hired those Afghan warlords, and he's actually the real bad guy of the movie. And he is trying to create his own armor. He can build the armor, but he can't build the heart of it, which is, of course, symbolic. And so he paralyzes Tony and plucks the sleek new heart device out of his chest, steals the heart, puts it in his own armor. Now, what can Tony do? Well, luckily, Pepper decided not to destroy that heart device. Instead, what do you get for the man who has everything? She decided to encase that old heart device in glass with an inscription saying, "Proof that Tony Stark has a heart." Tony then has to crawl through his house without the sleek new heart device, and crawl down the steps and crawl through his lab and get the old abandoned heart device. The heart that he gave to Pepper, he gets back to put inside his own chest. So now he goes into the final battle using his old heart device while Stane is using his new heart device. This can be seen either as a fight between Pepper's heart and Stane's heart, or as a fight between the third world heart and the first world heart. Now, a lot of this sounds heavy-handed when I spell it out, but that's the beauty of it. The movie doesn't have to spell it out. We would reject these messages if we heard them, but instead we're feeling them. We're feeling it because it's being said with objects instead of words. Think of all the dialogue exchanges that this object exchange has replaced. Tony doesn't have to talk anywhere near as much about how he feels about his weapons killing innocents, or how he feels about Pepper, or how she feels about him, or how it feels to be betrayed. It allows Tony to remain the happy-go-lucky guy we want him to be, because we have this object to tell us a lot of the things that he doesn't want to say. It also allows the film to discuss politics less openly, which allows it to quietly make political points that the audience doesn't want to hear out loud. So that's another secretive story. For more great tips just like this one, be sure to pick up my book, The Secrets of Story, Innovative Tools for Perfecting Your Fiction and Captivating Readers. Just click this link right on your screen, and you can order the book right now. Thank you so much.